This teaching you're about to listen to was preached by Jegede Sunday E and recorded live at God's Family Bible Church, Trinidad. Jegede Sunday E is the General Coordinator of Arabs of Revival Ministries and the School of Discipleship. He is also the Missionary Pastor of GFBC Trinidad under the leadership of Pastor Abolaji Akimbo, the General Overseer of God's Family Bible Church Worldwide, Palm Coast, Florida. Listen and be transformed.
Oh, Father, tonight in the name of Jesus, as we'll approach your word with all humility, as we'll approach your word with openness and readiness and excitement, we ask, Father, that once again, as never before, we shall behold the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ. And Lord, as we behold his glory, that our lives, our conduct, and our character will be transformed, Lord, that we become more and more like your Son, Jesus. Oh, thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Tonight, in the name of Jesus, we'll embrace the ministry of the Holy Spirit. And you, Spirit of Truth, we welcome you to teach us the truth of God's word, to reveal to us that which belongs to Christ. Thank you, Father. And as a welcome for tonight, there is salvation. The sick are healed. The captives are set free. And Lord, questions are answered. Needs are met. Miracles unto the glory of God, and your church is built up and edified in the truth. Thank you, Father, and in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Tonight, I'm so excited. We are starting a new teaching series, very beautiful, enlightening teaching series. I trust God that this teaching series is going to actually change your life, transform your life. I'm talking of your character, your conduct, to become more like that of Christ. Glory be to God. So this teaching series, I title it The Renewal of Your Mind, but it can go with various titles, all right? Now, so when you turn to Revised Standard Version, Revised Standard Version, Romans chapter 12, verse 2, the Bible says, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind. So that's what we'll be talking about, the renewal of your mind. And it says, so that you may prove what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. And when you turn the same scripture, the same verse, the same chapter to New King James, rather than calling it the renewal of your mind, it is called the renewing of your mind. Romans chapter 12 verse 2, New King James, and do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. So still the same thing, the renewal of your mind, or if you may, you can call it the renewing of your mind. And when you go to Passion Translation, Romans chapter 12, the same scripture, look at the way Passion Translation put it. It says, stop imitating the ideals and opinions of the culture all around you, but be inwardly transformed by the Holy Spirit through a total reformation of how you think. So still the same thing. So the renewal of your mind, or the renewing of your mind, or a total reformation of how you think. So for a few weeks, that is what we are going to be considering. That's what we are going to be studying. And of course, God's Word Translation, I love the simple way God's Word Translation put it here. Don't become, the same scripture, Romans 12 verse 2. Now, don't become like the people of this world. Instead, change the way you think. Change the way you think. So, this teaching series, you can call it the renewal of your mind, just as we see in Revised Standard Version, or you call it the renewing of your mind, just as New King James Version presented, or a total reformation of how you think, just as Passion Translation render it. And if you may, you can call it changing the way you think. Glory be to God. Praise God. So that is what we'll be considering for few weeks as the Lord will help us. Now let's go to Romans chapter 12. Romans chapter 12. I would love to read New King James, and I want to start from verse 1. Romans chapter 12. But before I start, I'm just going to read two verses. But you see, I want to give you a background context to the book of Romans. It is very important to always study the Bible in its proper context. So you don't just take a verse of the Bible and just apply any meaning to it or make it say what is not saying when it is put back in its proper context. So the background context to the book of Romans is important because we'll be looking into the book of Romans a lot. So it is important for us to understand. Now, I will start reading from chapter 12, but I wanted to actually know what Paul, the writer of epistle to the Romans, really has in mind. Praise God. So first, let's start with a background context to the book of Romans. This is Bible study, and so we are studying the Bible. Now, Apostle Paul was actually the one who wrote this epistle. Epistle simply means a formal long letter that is written. All right, so Paul was at Corinth at this time, and this is towards the end of his third missionary journey. Scholar says that is around AD 56. So Paul was at Corinth, all right? And Paul had heard about the church, the faith of the church at Rome. You remember, Rome was then the hub, the capital of the then Roman Empire. That was the capital of the Roman Empire. And there was a church planted there. According to the church history, nobody could say who actually planted the Roman church, the church at Rome. All right. But then it was said it could be one of the people that were converted on the day of Pentecost. All right. But then, so none of the apostles had ever been to the church at Rome. And Paul, inspired by the Holy Spirit, wanted to visit them. But for one reason or the other, later we got to know that is God's providence. Paul was delayed in his visit. He couldn't make it to Rome. And so Paul decided to write them a beautiful masterpiece of our gospel doctrine that we call the book of Romans. If you have never studied the book of Romans, then you know little about Christian doctrine. So the book of Romans, or the epistle to the Romans, is what the scholar called the masterpiece of the doctrines of Christ, the masterpiece of gospel doctrine. So Paul decided to write a letter to them, all right? And of course, you know, as an apostle, now he has never been there before. He was not so sure if they understood the basics of the gospel. So Paul started with that, all right? He started with righteousness by faith, justification by faith. And this was what Paul wrote to them, all right? So Paul wrote to them about the righteousness of faith, justification, and all that. What was Paul trying to do? Paul was setting before them the gospel truths, the gospel teachings, the gospel messages that he would have taught them if he had been able to go there physically, all right? But listen to this. Pay attention. This is where I'm coming to. Now, when you get to chapter 9 and 10, now, Paul began to talk about the Jewish people. He began to talk about the nation of Israel. Paul began to talk about the rejection of the nation of Israel as a result of them rejecting the gospel of Christ. In chapter 10, he told us that they were zealous, but they were not zealous according to knowledge. They rejected righteousness by faith. They wanted to obtain righteousness by the keeping of the law. Do you understand what I'm talking about? Now, why was Paul writing this to the Gentile convert at Rome? Now, Paul was writing to them, pay attention, don't miss this. Paul was writing to them to establish the fact, number one, that Israel rejection is not final, all right? Now, when you read chapter 11, he was telling them that the nation of Israel will still be engrafted back. They will be restored. That was Paul's conviction. But not only that, Paul also was writing them and talking about the rejection of Israel so that the Gentile church, as it were, will not boast against the nation of Israel. So he was warning them, do not brag, do not boast against them. Guys, you are saved by the mercy of God. That's what Paul was writing to them. He said, look, guys, you are saved by the mercy of God. Paul actually used analogy of a natural olive tree and a wild olive tree. So Paul referred to us as Gentiles. Those of us now who are non-Jew, but now we are Christians. We are believers. We put our faith in Christ. We are children of God. Paul referred to us as branches of wild olive tree, but by the mercy of God, we were cut off and then we were grafted in into the natural olive tree, referring to Christ. And Paul referred to the nation of Israel as the natural branches of this olive tree, but because they held onto the law of Moses, rather than accepting the gospel of Christ, they are broken away from Christ. They are cut off from Christ, but Paul said, it is for a while, they will still be restored. Now, pay attention. I'm going somewhere. This is just a background account. So now we get to Romans chapter 12. Now, so let's go to Romans chapter 12. That's just a brief synopsis of what the book of Romans is all about. All right? So, Romans chapter 11, Paul warned the Gentile convert not to boast against the Jew, but to consider the goodness and the mercy of God. Paul was telling them, don't forget, you guys were strangers, aliens from the commonwealth of Israel. You are without God, but by the mercy of God, by the goodness of God, by the grace of God, you are now part of the household of God. You are now members of the church, members of Christ. So in chapter 12 now, look at 1 and 2. Now, I told you we are starting a new teaching series, and today is just a kind of introduction. We just want to lay a solid foundation, and subsequent week, we continue to build on that. So Romans chapter 12, this is the renewing of your mind, part 1. The renewal of your mind, reformation of the way you think, changing the way you think. So Romans chapter 12 now. So we are in Romans chapter 12. I'm going to read verses 1 and 2. Now pay close attention. I'm going to dwell on this. We're going to look at some keywords in Greek here so that we can have a good understanding of what the writer is presenting to us. So Romans chapter 12, 1 and 2. Paul now, I beseech you therefore, brethren, referring to the Gentile convert, the church at Rome, by the mercy of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. Verse 2, and do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. So let's look at this scripture very carefully now. So let's go back to verse 1. So Paul, he just told them in chapter 1 that they were saved by the goodness of God, by the mercy of God, not because they deserve it, all right? They were not actually natural children of Abraham, but by the mercy of God, wild branches of olive tree was grafted in into the natural olive tree. So Paul now said, so brethren, by the mercy of God, I beseech you. Now, we need to pay close attention to the word by there and the word present, all right? In verse 1, and when we get to verse 2, we're going to look closely at the word conform, world, transform, renewing, mind, and prove, all right? So this is Bible study, so let's study the Bible. All right, so Paul say, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercy of God. What is Paul talking about? The word by there, B-Y, is the Greek word D-I-H. D-I-A. So the Greek word translated to by is the word D-I-H in Greek. What does it mean? It means the ground or the reason by which something is done. It means the reason why you did something, because of why you do something, by reason of what you do something. Now, pay attention. So Paul is saying to them, guys, you know what? I want you to present yourself as a living sacrifice to God. And Paul said, this is your worship. This is your logical service, all right? And Paul said, please be careful. I want you to have a right motive, a correct motive. I want you to do it by the mercy of God. And that means I want you to do it on the ground of the mercy of God. I want you to do it because of the mercy of God. Pay attention. So Paul was saying, guys, in your service to God, I don't want you to see your service to God as a leverage with God. I don't want you to see it as a bargaining power with God. I don't want you to see it as a means of meriting or earning or deserving anything from God. No. But see, today, many of us, that's the way we see our service to God. All right? Now, don't forget, we are talking of renewing our mind. So Paul here is already talking about that. He said, guys, you serve God because of what he has already done. The mercy that God has already shown you. You are not serving God so that God can look at your service and respond to you. No. Paul said reasonable service, logical service, true worship is your response to the mercy that God has shown you. That is very important. You see, if you miss that, all your life, you will be trying to impress God with your service. You'll be trying to deserve things from God. You'll be trying to use your service as a leverage. You'll be trying to use your service as a bargaining power with God. But then you are back to the law. That's what Paul is telling them. Guy, it is because. That is why in chapter 11, he focused on the mercy. Guys, you are saved by the mercy of God. You are saved by the goodness of God. So in chapter 12, verse 1, he says, now I want your worship to be because of the mercy that you have received. Do you get that? That is important. So it is important to understand that the only ground, the only legitimate ground of serving God is because of what he has already done for us. Do you get what I'm talking about? All right. You see, this will change the way you view service. If you truly understand it, that service to God must be by the mercy, because of the mercy that we have received. So that is important. And Paul went forward and told them, said, so by the mercy of God, present your body. That is important. So Paul said, present your body. What does that mean? What is Paul referring to? The word present there is the Greek word that is called parastemi. Is the word parastemi. And the word parastemi simply means to place a person or a thing at the disposal of another one. It simply means that you take, for instance, you have something and you want me to use it, so you place it at my disposal. It is standing by for my use. It is standing ready for my use. So anytime I need it, I don't have to stretch. I don't have to shout. I don't have to scream. I just reach out and use it. So Paul said, that is the way true worship is. So, through worship to God, through service to God, pay close attention to this, is simply you presenting yourself. And what that simply means, making yourself available for God's use. Putting yourself at God's disposal. It means you are always standing by, standing ready. So, at your workplace, God wants to speak to someone. God wants to reach out to someone. God doesn't need to look far. I am standing by. Are you listening to me? He speaks of yieldingness to God. He speaks of sensitivity to God. And listen to me, brethren, that is what true worship is. Are you listening to what I'm talking about? That is what God regards as true worship. That is what Paul called reasonable service. Guys, you don't belong to yourself anymore. Purchased with the blood. You are now God's sacrifice. Are you listening to me? Just like under the law, right? A guy will go to the market because he wants to worship or offer a sacrifice for sin. Then he goes and buy a bull or goat. Once he paid for it, that bull or goat becomes his own sacrifice. Is that right? Are you listening to what I'm talking about? And then he can do whatever he wants with that bull or goat. Paul is saying, have you forgotten? You are bought with the blood of Jesus. So you are God's sacrifice. But God is not going to drag you along. Are you listening to me? God is not going to compel you. God is not going to use you against your wish. Paul said, present yourself. So I wake up in the morning and I tell God, I am available for your use today. You can walk in me. You can walk through me. You want to show love to someone, I'm available. You want to bless someone, I'm available. You want to preach the gospel to someone, I'm available. I am yielded to God. That is reasonable service. Are you listening to what I'm talking about, all right? So that is what Paul is saying in Romans chapter 12, verse 1. So guy, because of what God has done, his mercy that he has shown me, the goodness of God that I've seen, salvation, eternal life that I have, so I yield myself to God. If I understand this too, I will never again struggle with God. Are you listening to what I'm talking about? Because I'm responding to him because of the mercy and also because of the truth that I do not belong to myself again. I've been purchased by the blood of Jesus. Now, let's go to verse 2 now. All right. So Romans chapter 12, we are looking at this scripture very closely. So verse 2 now, Paul say, and do not. All right. So Paul say, guys, that is not the end of it. Not only must you yield yourself, not only must you make yourself available, not only must you stand by and stand ready for God's use. Whenever God wants to use someone, not only must you make yourself available, Paul say, do not conform to this world. Let's look at that word conform and the word very closely. The word conform there is the Greek word susematizo. Susematizo. Now that is what, and what does that mean? It simply means to conform, or rather to fashion your mind and your character according to another. So Paul is saying this, guys, I know it. You do not belong to the world. You know it. You are bought with the blood of Christ. And God has changed you. Now, pay attention. Don't miss this. Now, the truth is this. We do not belong to the world anymore. Inwardly, we have been changed to become like Christ. 1 Corinthians 6, 17 says, who is joined to the Lord is one spirit with him. All right? We've got a new heart. We are a new man within. Is that right? Now, so our heart resembles that of Christ. Our inward man, our new man, is conformed to the image of Christ. So Paul knows that. Paul is not asking them to be conformed to Christ in their heart, but Paul is focusing on their conduct, their character, their behavior, their lifestyle. Are you listening to what I'm talking about? So Paul is saying it is possible for your heart to be conformed to Christ, but your character not to be conformed to Christ. So Paul is saying, guys, you know what? Don't yield yourself to God for God to use you. And when your colleagues at work, when they examine your life, your conduct, your character, you are just like them. There is no difference, all right? And you want to preach the gospel to them, but just few minutes ago, you gossiped together, all right? Few minutes ago, they had you lie about something. Do you understand what I'm talking about? That's what Paul is telling them. Guys, do not be conformed to the world. In other words, do not fashion your character. Do not fashion your conduct like the world. The word there is the Greek word aion. A-I-O-N. Aion is simply mean period of time or age. So Paul is saying, guys, I don't want you to conform your character. I don't want your character, your conduct to be like the people of this age. He's talking of the culture that we are now. So he said, guy, don't be like every other person you see in Rome. Are you listening? You are different. Christ has come to live in you. You've got a new heart. You've got a new nature. You have the Spirit of God living in you. But Paul says, do something about your character. Do not conform. In other words, don't let your character be like the people of the world. But look at what he says further now. He said, but do something. Do something. But be transformed. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Very important. Be transformed. What does it mean to be transformed? That is the Greek word metamorphao. That's from the word we got the English word metamorphosis. So what that means is to change into another form. You remember metamorphosis of butterfly, all right? The pupa, that worm becomes a butterfly. That is a complete change of form. You can't see any resemblance again. Is that right? All right. The worm, what they call it, the pupa is, has many legs and is worm crawling, but butterfly has beautiful wings and it can fly. It has changed form completely. So Paul is saying, that is what is expected of me as a believer, as a Christian. Now, I don't look like the world in terms of my conduct and character. I am changed completely. That when my old friend sees me, are you listening to what I'm talking about? When they see me, when I interact with them, they look at me and say, you've changed really completely. This is not you again. That is what Paul is talking about. That is what it means to metamorpho, to be transformed. That is, you are changed. Now, more and more, my conduct, my character is becoming like that of Christ, and the people of the world can see it clearly. Are you listening to me? They know who I used to be. Now they are seeing who I have become, and they are saying, wait a minute, what happened to you? What happened to me is that I metamorpho. I am being transformed into what? The image of Christ. Not in my heart anymore, but in my character. Do you understand what we are talking about? And this is where we are coming to. This is why we are looking at this teaching series. And Paul said, this is only going to happen. He said, but be transformed by what? The renewing of your mind. Paul said, guys, it has to be by the renewing of your mind. The word renewing there, or the word renew there, is the Greek word anakinosis. Very interesting word. It means renewal. It means renovation. It means a complete change. But pay attention, not just a change to something, but a change for better. All right? So Paul is saying, guys, let me tell you how your character, how your conduct, how your lifestyle, how your behavior is going to be progressively changed to become more and more like that of Christ. It is by your thinking. It is by the renewing of your mind. A complete renovation of your mind. A total reformation of how you think. That is important. Now, as we go in this teaching series, we are going to place emphasis on this truth. All right? But that, I just want you to know, the word mind there is the Greek word nous, N-O-U-S, and it means a particular mode of thinking and judging. Now, so Paul is saying, now guys, do not be conformed to this world. Don't be like them in your conduct and in your character, but rather let your conduct and your character, your behavior, your lifestyle be changed and be progressively changed to become more like that of Christ. But Paul say this is determined or dependent upon you changing the mode of your thinking and judging. So, if my mode of thinking is not changed, my conduct and character will not change. That's what Paul is talking about. So, the renewal of the mind here means the renovation of my mode of thinking, the way I think, the way I see things, the way I perceive things, the way I judge things. Paul says that has to change. And quickly, Paul talks about one of the benefits of this. He said that you may prove. The word prove there is the Greek word dokimasso. It means to test something, to scrutinize something, to examine something to see whether it is genuine or not. So Paul is saying, if my mind is being progressively changed, my mode of thinking and judging is gradually aligning with that of Christ. That is, I'm beginning to see, I'm beginning to think, I'm beginning to judge things like Christ. Paul said, it will be easy for me to recognize the will of God. All right? There will be no confusion about, I don't know the will of God. If your mind is transforming enough, knowing the will of God is easy. That's what Paul is talking about. Do we all understand that? Glory be to God, all right? So that is Romans chapter 12, 1 and 2. That is our test for this teaching series. And that is why I've taken time to examine this scripture, these verses in their proper context, all right? Now, so as we start today, renewing the mind or renewal of your mind, reformation of your mind or changing the way you think, part one, there are two basic foundational truths that we need to examine. I told you today is just introduction. We are just laying a foundation, and God help us. We want to lay a solid foundation. All right. In this teaching series, we'll be asking so many questions. You know, like, what does it mean to renew our mind? Now, why do I need to do that? All right. I am saved. God has changed my heart. Why do I have to care about my mind? Why do I have to change my mode of thinking? Why do I have to change my mode of judging? All right. Why can't I just be pleased that God has changed my heart? Why does my character need to change? This is a question we'll be asking. And how can I do that? All right. Now, I've been hearing in the church about renew your mind. How do I do that practically? All right. And of course, how do I know if I'm doing it well? How do I measure or determine my progress in renewing my mind? These are many questions will be answered by the help of God in this teaching series. So get ready to learn in this teaching series. So two truths. Let's see how far we can go with that. Two basic foundational truths that I want us to consider in this introduction. Number one, I want you to know the salvation. I believe you know it. I just want to remind you that salvation or the new birth experience is an instant spiritual transformation. It is an instant inward transformation. It's an instant heart transformation. The day I acknowledge Jesus and I confess him as my Lord and Savior, there is a change that took place within me. You can't see because it is spiritual. All right. You may not feel it because it happens inwardly. It is a heart transformation. So the only thing that God did the day Jesus came into my heart is that God changed my heart. God made me a new man, a new spirit. And of course, that is what God promised, isn't it? All right. Ezekiel 36:26, God says, I will give you a new heart, talking about the new covenant, and put a new spirit within you. I will take the heart of stone out of your flesh. Ezekiel 36:26, I will take the heart of stone out of your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and you will keep my judgment and do them. God has already done that. Praise God. So I've got a new heart. I have a new spirit within me, and the spirit of God now dwell in me. Are you listening to what I'm talking about? But listen to what salvation is not. All right. So salvation is a complete radical change of my heart, a radical change of my nature, a radical change of my spirit. But it is not a radical change of my character. Pay attention. That is important. You need to know this, that salvation of the new birth experience is not an instant physical change. It's not an instant physical transformation. How many of us were transformed physically the day that we became born again? No, I was not changed. All right. The same way I went to church, the same way I left. Are you listening to what I'm talking about? Because being born again is an inward thing. It's a spiritual thing. We know that scripture, popular scripture, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, NIV. I prefer to read in NIV. It said, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, that is, if anyone belongs to Christ, the new creation has come, the old has gone, the new is here. The word new there is the Greek word kainos. It means something that is just made. It means something that is entirely new. So if that is true, all right, so the Bible says, when I join myself with Christ, or when Christ comes to live in me, I become a new person. And I told you that word new is kainos. It means something that is just made. Something that has never been in existence before. So God gave me a heart that has never been in existence before. God put a new spirit within me that has never been in existence before. That is what God did. God didn't change my body, all right? So salvation is not a physical transformation, all right? God did it. It is also, pay attention, salvation is also not a mental transformation, all right? So being saved does not mean you are changed or transformed mentally, all right? My mind never changed. The thing I knew, all right, before I went to the service, when I left, I still remember them clearly. If God changed my mind, if salvation is a mental transformation, when I walk out of that service, the day I became born again, I will not remember my name again. I will not even remember my house again because my mind has been formatted. All right? Because I've got a new mind. But thank God, God didn't do that. How will I have got home that day? All right? Now, so salvation is not a mental transformation. Salvation is not also emotional transformation. God did nothing to my emotions, to my feelings. Salvation is also not character transformation, all right? My character didn't change, all right? So don't get disappointed that I just told you I'm born again and the next 1 hour I've lost my temper again. And you say, but you just became born again. Yes, being born again is just a change of heart, not a change of character. Do you get what I'm talking about? Now, that is important. We are going somewhere. So this is what happened the day we became born again. So salvation, as it were, is an instantaneous change of your spiritual status, your spiritual condition, and your spiritual position. But it is not an instantaneous change of your actions and emotions. Do you understand what I'm talking about, all right? But listen to this. Number two truth. I told you two basic truths I want us to understand. One is what salvation is. What salvation is not. Salvation is an instant, radical, complete change of my nature, of my heart, of my spirit. But not a radical change of my mind. Not a radical change of my body. Not a radical change of my emotions. Not a radical change of my character. But now listen to this. This is the second truth that I want you to go on with. I want you to know that God's goal, God's expectation after you are saved is that you will be progressively, continuously, continually, increasingly be transformed. That is, be changed in your conduct, in your character, in your behavior, in your lifestyle, in your attitude to become more and more like Christ. Now listen to it. So God changed my heart. He didn't change my character at the new birth. But God now set a goal. God now has an expectation, all right? That now that I am saved, by the help of His Spirit in me, all right? And also by me playing my own part, my conduct and character will begin to change gradually but steadily to become like that of Christ. Are you listening to what I'm talking about? Maybe you are not impressed with my characters at this time. Be patient with me. All right? Now, God is patient. It is a goal. It is an expectation. God does not expect that in 1 year, I'll become perfectly like Christ in my conduct and character. No, that is not the goal of God. But that progressively, continuously, increasingly, until when I see Christ face to face, God wants me to continue to become like Christ in my conduct and in my character. Are you listening to what I'm talking about? Praise God. Let's quickly jump into the word of God. All right. We read these while we are praying. Second Corinthians chapter 3. Let me jump to verse 18 because of time. Amplify. Now Paul says, and we all with unveiled face continually seeing as in a mirror the glory of the Lord. What he called the mirror there is the pages of the scripture. That as I continually look into the word of God and I see the glory of God, what they refer to as the glory of God is that I see the character of Christ. I see the humility of Christ. I see the love of Christ. As I see the patience of Christ. As I see the long suffering of Christ. As I see the kindness of Christ. With the help of the Holy Spirit at work in me, now God begins to change me. Are you listening to what I'm talking about? And I'm becoming like what I see. Becoming more loving like Him. Becoming more patient like Him. Becoming kinder like Him. That is what the scripture is talking about. That we are progressively being transformed into His image. Whose image? Christ's image. Christ's likeness. Christ's character. From one degree of glory to even more glory. Can you see? It is not something that happened once. Are you listening to me? It is something that takes place, that gets better. It is something that increases. It is something that is progressive, that is progressive. And he said, this comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. Let's look at Romans chapter 8. I want you to know that this is God's desire, ultimate goal and expectation for all His children. If you are one of God's children, this is God's goal for you. And as we close tonight, I want you to to hold this tightly. God has an expectation. God has a desire. God has a goal. And that God wants you to become increasingly like Christ in your attitude, in your conduct, in your character, in your behavior, in the way you love, in your patience, in the way you treat people, in the way you endure. Now, look at Romans 8:29-30. He said, those whom God had already chosen. Are you one of us? I am chosen. Are you chosen? So, he said, those who God had already chosen, he had also set apart to what? To become like his son. What are you talking about? We are like his son in our heart. We are like his son inwardly. We are like his son in his nature, in his life, but we are not like him in our conduct, in our character, in our attitude, in our judgment, in our perception. But God wants us to become like his son, so that the son will be what? The eldest brother in a large family. Isn't that awesome? That we all just be like Christ. Hallelujah. Now, if you go to Christ, the way Christ treats you, that is the way I will treat you when you come to me. That's what he's talking about. Now, look at verse 30. And so those whom God set apart, that is us, he called. Those he called, he put right with himself, and he share his glory with them. Hallelujah. He share his nature, his life with us. I love the way Message Bible put it. Let's read that. Message Bible. Okay, the same scripture. Now, Message Bible, Romans 8:29. He said God knew what he was doing from the very beginning. So what was God doing from the very beginning? He said he decided from the outset. God decided from the outset. Even before I was saved, before I was born, before you were born, God decided from the outset to shape the lives of those who love him along the same lines as the life of his son. God decided that Jesus will be the model. Jesus will be the pattern. And that my life will be shaped according to his pattern. Are you listening to what I'm talking about? That is God's decision. That is God's goal. That is God's expectation. That is God's desire. Look at it. He read forward. I said, the son stand first. In the line of humanity restored, we see the original and intended shape of our life dealing in. Hallelujah. That is why we've got to just focus on Christ. Are you listening to me? He's the original shape. Look at what he said. He's the intended model. He's the intended pattern that God wants for my life. Are you listening to what I'm talking about? That is why I must set him before me. That is why when I look at the scripture, open the scripture, I want to see Jesus. Do you know why? Because it is God's original and intended shape and molded pattern and example for my life. That is important. Now, let's read further. Now, look at what it says, verse 30 now. After God made that decision of what his children should be like. Do you know what God's children should be like? Like Christ Jesus. In conduct, in character, in attitude, in thought, in desires. Are you with me? Now look at what he say. He follow it up. I just love God, right? So God set a goal for me. God set an expectation, but God wouldn't leave me to it. Because on my own, I will fail again and again and again. Are you listening to what I'm talking? God said, don't worry. Now, we are going to walk together towards that goal. Don't worry, we are going to reach that destination together. I put my spirit within you, and I will walk along with you as you are changed progressively. Look at what the Bible says. After God made that decision of what his children should be like, he followed it up by calling people by name. After he called them by name, he set them on a solid basis with himself. And you listen to me, he gave us his righteousness. He said, when you fall, no condemnation. When you fail, no condemnation. When you fail to watch over your mouth, when you lose your cool, when you lose your temper, when you fall into temptation, God said, no condemnation. You are standing on a solid base with me. You listen to what I'm talking about. So what do you do? Rise up again. If you are falling, shake yourself. The journey is still far. God has a goal, an expectation. And that is that you become like Christ in your conduct, in your character. If you fall, if you fail, don't sit down there and think that God has written you up. No, God is working along with you. He set us on a solid basis with him, with himself. That is powerful. That is powerful. Look at what he said. And he then, after getting them established, After establishing us in his righteousness. That is why you've got to be established in the righteousness of God, that you are right with God. He stay with them to the end. Hallelujah. God stay with us. What? He will stay with us till the end. I love this. Gloriously completing what he had begun. Hallelujah. God will complete his work in our life. Is somebody listening to me as we pray? I said, God will complete his work in your life. He has started. Have you fallen? No, you are still in the process. You are still in the process. In the process of becoming more and more like God's intended shape, intended model and pattern, which is Christ Jesus. Let's rise to our feet. But you see something. Now listen to this. Now this is dependent on you renewing your mind. That is my role. That is my role. God is going to stay with me. When I fall, God is going to pick me up. No condemnation for me. God has established me in his righteousness. God has set me on a solid basis. God is going to stay with me till the very end. But listen to this. I've got a role to play. What is my role? I need to start changing my thinking. I need to renew my mind. How do I do that? That is why we are considering this teaching series. And we're going to stop here. We're going to continue next week. Glory be to God. Lift up your hand and say, Father, thank you. Thank you because you are going to stay with me till the end. It doesn't matter how many times I fail. It doesn't matter how many times I fall. You are staying with me till the end. Lord, you are staying with me till the end. You will gloriously complete what you have begun. God will complete it. God has started his work. He started at the new birth. He started the day Jesus came into our life. And God has no intention of giving up. God has no intention of chasing me away. Are you listening to what I'm talking about? God will gloriously complete what he has started in our life. Father, we thank you. We thank you, Father, because Lord, tonight we have seen that you have started a mighty work, a glorious work in our life. The work of changing us in our conduct and our character to become like your son, Christ Jesus. And Father, we thank you because it doesn't matter how many times we fall short, how many times we stumble, how many times we fumble, how many times we fall, how many times we fail, you will stay with us till the end. You will not give up on us. You will complete gloriously that which you have started. What a good father you are. What a good father you are. Father, we just ask, as we continue in this teaching series, that our hearts and our mind will be open to the role that you have given unto us, the path that you have given unto us to play, so that our lives and our conduct will be changed progressively, even as you desire to become more and more like your son. Thank you, Father. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Praise God. Glory be to God.
We hope you have been challenged, encouraged, and motivated to become more like Christ by today's teaching. If you would like to find out more about Eras of Revival and get additional teachings and materials for your healthy, spiritual growth, visit our website today at www.erasofrevival.org. Or if you would like to enroll at our School of Discipleship, visit our website www.theschoolofdiscipleship.org.uk. This teaching was made possible by the prayers and generous free will offering, donation, and gifts from partners like you. You are welcome into partnership with us today. For information on how to become a partner, please call 1-868-292-9270 or 1-866-703-5572, or you can email us at info@erasofrevival.org.uk. Thanks for listening.